Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Wok, Recipes and Techniques by J. Kenji Lopez-Alt, narrated by Eric Jason Martin. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type The Wok into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code SAUCE and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All recipes, photographs, charts, tables, and references referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. Meet the most versatile pan in your kitchen. Since writing my first book, The Food Lab, Better Home Cooking Through Science, a lot of things have changed. I spent several years living in San Mateo, California, before moving to Seattle. I now have a normal-sized American kitchen, even though I dearly miss my small, extraordinarily functional New York galley-style kitchen. I actually have to walk between my counter and my stovetop, much to my chagrin. I'm something called a YouTube creator and an influencer. I've got kids. All of these factors mean that fast, fresh cooking is the order of the day, and that's why I reach for my wok more than any other pan in my kitchen. Do you know the principle of Chekhov's gun? It's a basic rule in good storytelling, coined by Russian playwright Anton Chekhov, that states that if a loaded gun is introduced to the story, it had better go off before you reach the end. Dear listeners, I apologize, for I broke this rule in The Food Lab. My Chekhov's gun? The wok. Despite spending 2 pages expounding on its usefulness, despite declaring that it is the most commonly used pan in my home kitchen, I failed to provide a single recipe for it. Here, I intend to fix that. By the end of this book, not only will you be firing out delicious recipes from your wok left and right, you'll have learned the skills required to throw together a meal using virtually any meat, vegetable, or plant-based protein source you find in your fridge, whether you have a lazy afternoon to cook or a harried half hour while simultaneously handling a toddler. As far as putting dinner on the table quickly and easily, nothing beats stir-frying in a wok. It's the quintessential weeknight supper. Because the actual cooking is so fast, it's also an ideal summer meal. No heating up the house with a hot oven or a long simmering pot. It's also a fantastic way to showcase good ingredients. Vegetables retain their bright color and crunch. Proteins come out tender and flavor-packed. And there's no reason to stick with just Asian ingredients. Asparagus, corn, zucchini, string beans, peas, fava beans, almost any firm vegetable you can think of makes for wonderful stir fries. The Asian American restaurant staples of beef, pork, chicken, and shrimp are also only the tip of the iceberg. Firm fish and shellfish are prime stir fry candidates, as are tofu, seitan, and other vegetarian protein sources. But it doesn't end there. The wok is also the ideal vessel for deep-frying at home. Goodbye, stovetop splatter. You can use it to steam vegetables, dumplings, and, well, anything steamable. It doubles as an indoor quick smoker. Home-smoked cheese, home-smoked duck, home-smoked whiskey. And it's great for stovetop braising meats and vegetables. When it comes to producing quick, flavorful, and versatile meals, the wok beats every other pan in the kitchen, hands down. Wok history. There are plenty of other books that talk about the history of the wok. I'm a cook with a penchant for science, not a historian, so I see no reason to go into great detail here when other people already do it so much better. Long story short, the origins of the wok are unclear, but in all likelihood, it was introduced to China from a neighboring country sometime during the Han Dynasty, right around the BC to AD changeover, as a clay vessel designed for drying grains. By the Ming Dynasty, around 700 years ago, metal woks used for stir-frying were popularized and have gone on to become the most common cooking method throughout the country. My own introduction to the wok was during the MacGyver Dynasty, right around the 80s to 90s changeover, as an infomercial designed for selling kitchen gadgets. By the MacGyver Reboot Dynasty, it had gone on to become the most common cooking method throughout my kitchen. "It's the Great Wok of China," exclaims Arnold Morris in the middle of his half-hour infomercial. The late 1980s were prime infomercial time, and along with Mr. Wizard's World and He-Man, they were a staple of my childhood viewing. I loved all those kitchen gadgets, but even then I could see through most of them as a gimmick. Ron Popeil's Chop-O-Matic, the greatest kitchen appliance ever made. Vegematic, sliced tomatoes so thin they only have one side. And Showtime Rotisserie, set it and you can finish the rest, I'm sure, captured my attention, but not my curiosity. But that hand-hammered wok. I was familiar with woks growing up. My mother, who moved to the United States from Japan in her late teens, had a small carbon steel number that she used for deep-frying gyoza and Japanese-style croquettes, or for making fried rice and Chongqing pork. But it was through one of those infomercials that I really started getting curious about the wok. My current wok is the same one that I've used since buying it in the early 2000s. The quality of my relationship with it is only barely bested by that with my wife, my daughter, and some members of my extended family. If you are ready to start down the path of your own lifelong commitment to an inanimate object, then listen on. Sidebar: why technique over recipes? Don't get me wrong, there are plenty of recipes in this book, and if you're the type who just wants to follow instructions and leave the planning to someone else, that's totally fine. I promise, the recipes will work for you. But if, on the other hand, you have that desire to be in charge of your own destiny, to cook that meal that's custom-suited for future you, then I hope you'll find the lengthy in-between-the-recipes sections of this book even more interesting. I like to think of cooking as a map. Following a recipe is like getting turn-by-turn instructions, your face buried in your smartphone. Sure, with good recipes, you can get from point A, raw ingredients, to point B, delicious meals, and sometimes that's all you want. But learning the science and technique behind those recipes, that's like being given an atlas. It's full access to all of Google Maps, from the biggest bird's eye view to the details on each street. With that map at your disposal, you may find a better, more efficient way to get from A to B, custom suited to your cooking style or kitchen. You may, in fact, find that you'd rather go to B prime, or maybe even points X, Y, or Z. Sometimes you might plan on going from A to B, but find you're up against a roadblock. You're missing one of the ingredients in the list, or perhaps a piece of equipment. No problem. Armed with that map, with those techniques and science, you'll be able to find an alternate route with ease. If you're just starting out, I'm not going to kid you. It's going to take some learning and some commitment. But it's the fun kind of learning, and as long as you have a commitment to mapo tofu or tempura, you're going to do just fine. Buying a wok. Woks come in as many shapes, sizes, and materials as Western-style sauté pans and saucepots, but here is my quick and dirty recommendation for anyone who cooks on a standard Western-style range. Get yourself a 14-inch, flat-bottomed, carbon-steel wok made with material around 2 millimeters, 14-gauge, thick, with a single long handle and a helper handle on the opposite side. If you happen to live in a city with a sizable Chinese population, your best bet is to hit up a Chinese restaurant supply store. You'll find a variety of woks at really great prices. The wok shop in San Francisco's Chinatown has been selling high-quality woks for over 50 years. You can browse and order them from wokshop.com. Want a little more detail? Okay, here we go. Wok materials. Question: what metallurgical qualities are important when selecting a wok? Answer: woks come in a variety of materials, thicknesses, and finishes. There are four important qualities to consider in the material for your wok. The first three, specific heat capacity, density, and conductivity, are physical properties of the material itself, while the fourth, reactivity, is a function of a wok's material, thickness, and geometry. For now, we'll focus on the first three. Specific heat capacity is the amount of energy it takes to raise a specific amount of material a specific number of degrees. In metric, this is measured in kilojoules per kilogram per Kelvin. For instance, aluminum has a specific heat of 0.91. That means that it takes 0.91 kilojoules of energy to raise 1 kilogram of aluminum by 1 Kelvin, about 2 degrees Fahrenheit for those who are imperially inclined. Conversely, this means that for every Kelvin a kilogram of aluminum is at, it has 1 kilojoule of energy to give up either to the surrounding environment or the food in the pan. Cast iron, with a heat capacity of 0.46, holds about half as much energy as aluminum per unit weight. This means that given identical weights and starting temperatures, an aluminum pan will contain about twice as much heat energy as a cast iron pan. This gets more complicated when you take into account density. The density of a material is the ratio of weight to size. Aluminum has a density of 2.7 grams per cubic centimeter, whereas cast iron has a density of 7.2. This means that given two pans of identical shape and size, a cast iron pan will weigh about 2.5 times more than an aluminum pan. Thus, even though cast iron holds about half as much heat energy per unit weight, given identical shapes and sizes, a cast iron pan will hold about 1.25 times as much heat energy as an aluminum pan. These two concepts, heat capacity and density, can be combined into a more useful concept, volumetric heat capacity. Volumetric heat capacity is a measure of how much heat energy a given volume of a material will store, given a specific temperature. Conversely, it's also a measure of how much energy you need to add to a fixed volume of material to raise that material's temperature by a fixed number of degrees. Sound confusing? Here's an easy way to think of it. Every pan in your kitchen acts as a sort of reservoir or bucket of energy. Preheating a pan on a burner is sort of like pouring water into that bucket. The higher the volumetric heat capacity of the pan, the bigger that bucket, the longer it takes to fill up, and the more energy it will hold. A cast iron wok is a heat-storing bucket about 1.25 times, 25%, bigger than an aluminum wok of the same shape and size. Conductivity is a material's ability to get heat from one area to another. This applies to its ability to efficiently conduct heat from the heat source to the food, but also to its ability to conduct heat evenly throughout its cooking surface. Conductivity is more or less linear. It will take about twice as long for a 2 millimeter thick pan to conduct heat from the burner to the food than a 1 millimeter thick pan. If we go back to that bucket analogy, you can think of conductivity as the size of the spigot at the bottom of the bucket. The higher the conductivity, the bigger the spigot, and the faster you can pour energy from inside the bucket into the food you're cooking. If we were to look purely at heat capacity and conductivity, aluminum is the clear winner here. It stores plenty of heat, nothing has it beat, and transfers energy quickly. Only copper is more conductive. However, aluminum hits a snag in the density department. Because it is so light, you'd need a ludicrously thick aluminum pan to achieve the volumetric heat capacity of carbon or stainless steel. In other words, all else being equal, a 2 millimeter thick carbon steel pan will hold about 60% more energy at a given temperature than a 2 millimeter thick aluminum pan, though an aluminum pan will be about 4 times more conductive. Question: so what about this reactivity thing? Answer: reactivity is a pan's ability to react quickly to changes in heat input. If I switch off the heat, do the contents of the pan continue to sizzle and sweat, or do they cool rapidly? If I need a quick blast of heat, does the wok react fast enough when I turn the dial up? With a Western-style pan, we typically value consistency over reactivity. We want the pan to maintain a slow, steady sizzle as we add finely diced vegetables to sauté, and we want it to maintain a vigorous sizzle as we sear. Rarely in Western cuisine do you find yourself needing to go from a simmer to a sear to a gentle bubble in the course of a few moments. With wok cooking, this is a frequent occurrence. This quality is related to the conductivity of a wok's material. The more conductive, the more reactive, and its thickness, the thinner, the more reactive. But more importantly, the geometry of your wok and how it fits with your burner can have a big impact. Ideally, your wok should fit over your hottest burner with a wide enough flat-bottomed area that the ring of flames heats mostly the bottom, with a little bit of flame riding up the flared sides. This maximizes reactivity in the center of the pan, where you need it the most. Question: okay, so give it to me. Which material should I choose? Answer: stainless steel woks are expensive, heavy, difficult to maneuver, and not very reactive. The finish on stainless steel is also designed to be fully cleaned after each use, whereas a wok, like an old-fashioned cast-iron pan, should develop a dark patina over time that improves its functionality. I would not recommend a stainless steel wok unless you use your wok primarily for braising. Clad stainless steel: stainless steel with a layer of aluminum or copper sandwiched in between is even worse for woks. The layers of bonded metal expand and contract at different rates when heated, so preheating a clad pan to extreme temperatures, as woks frequently are, can cause the metal to split and the layers to separate. Likewise, solid copper woks, with their steel or tin lining, are a waste of money for the same reason. An even bigger waste: copper is significantly more expensive than steel. Aluminum distributes heat very evenly, which is a desirable characteristic for Western cooking, but not so much for wok cooking, where distinct cooking zones with different heat levels is desirable. Aluminum, with its low density, does not retain heat very well for a given wok thickness. Cast iron is a common traditional material, and while it has decent performance stats, its brittleness requires it to be rather thick and heavy in order not to crack or break with regular use. This makes for a heavy, cumbersome wok that isn't very reactive. Carbon steel is your best bet. Modern carbon steel pans are made of spun steel that is quite durable and unlikely to crack or break. A 14-gauge pan, about 2 millimeters thick, is thick enough to store a good amount of energy for searing, but thin enough that it will react to changes in burner input quickly. It's extremely inexpensive, and when properly used, it will end up with a practically non-stick surface. Question: what about non-stick woks? Answer: most non-stick coatings will begin to break down at around 450 degrees Fahrenheit. And by 650 degrees Fahrenheit, they are actively decomposing into toxic vapors. Most should not be heated above 450 degrees Fahrenheit or so. This is an inadequate temperature range for many stir fries, which rely on higher heat to rapidly cook foods while preserving their color and texture. Moreover, with a nonstick wok, you will achieve no wok hei, the smoky flavor you find in many restaurant-style dishes. Finally, nonstick surfaces are simply too nonstick for effective wok cooking. A small amount of sticking allows you to push food up the sides of the wok to clear space for new ingredients. Avoid nonstick woks. Wok design. Question: round-bottom woks are more authentic than flat-bottom woks, right? Which do you recommend? Answer. When it comes to stir-frying at home, flat-bottom woks make the wokin' world go round. Or go flat, that is. Traditional woks have a deep bowl shape designed to fit into a circular opening directly over the hearth. Most modern home ranges, both in the United States and in Asia, are designed for flat skillets. Unless you have a custom wok insert in your range, you want to avoid round-bottom or induction woks. They won't work, period, on an electric range, and are tough to use on a gas range, even with one of those wok rings that elevate it and hold it steady. These rings typically raise your wok too high above the heat source. Rather than absorbing all the heat, a lot of it is dissipated or gets deflected away as it travels up from the burner to the sides of the wok. On the other hand, woks with bottoms that are too flat defeat the purpose of a wok, making it tough to flip properly and to move food in and out of the high heat zone. Your best bet is a wok with a 4 to 5 inch flattened area at the bottom, with gently sloping sides that flare out to between 12 and 14 inches. This will give you plenty of high heat space for searing meats and vegetables at the bottom, while still providing ample volume and room to maneuver when flipping. Question. I've seen woks with long handles and short handles. Which style should I get? Answer. Cantonese-style woks have two ear-shaped looped metal handles welded or riveted onto either side. Northern-style woks, also known as pao woks, have a single long handle and frequently a loop-shaped helper handle on the opposite side. Neither style works, but northern-style long-handled woks tend to be easier for folks who are used to western-style long-handled skillets. Question. So what about those hand-hammered woks from those 80s infomercials? How important is it that a wok be hand-hammered? Answer. Woks are made in three ways. Traditional hand-hammered woks are an excellent choice. The slight indentations left by the hammering pattern allow you to push cooked food to the sides of the pan while adding ingredients to the center without their slipping. The only problem is that it can be difficult, perhaps impossible, to find a hand-hammered wok with a flat bottom and a handle. Stamped woks are made by cutting out a circular piece of thin carbon steel and machine pressing it into a mold. They are extremely cheap, but completely smooth, which makes it difficult to stir-fry properly in them. They are, without fail, made from low-gauge steel and prone to developing hot and cold spots, as well as feeling flimsy. Spun woks are produced on a lathe, giving them a distinct pattern of concentric circles. This pattern offers the same advantages as a hand-hammered wok, allowing you to easily keep your food in place against the side of the pan. Spun woks can be found in heavy gauges, with flat bottoms, and with flip-friendly handles. Fortunately, both spun woks and hand-hammered woks are inexpensive. Seasoning, cleaning, and maintaining a wok. Question. Okay, I've got my new carbon steel wok. It's kind of dull gray and looks like it's coated in oil. What do I need to do to start using it? Answer. Just like with a good cast iron or carbon steel pan, a carbon steel wok's performance will improve the more you use it. Most come with a protective film of oil on them to prevent them from rusting or tarnishing in the store, but it's important to remove this layer before using it the first time. First, scrub the wok out with hot, soapy water and dry it carefully. Next, heat up every metal surface over the flame of a gas burner, slowly rotating the pan until it starts to discolor and turn dark brown or black all over. If all you've got is an electric burner, you can achieve this process with a propane or butane torch or over an outdoor grill. This will vaporize any remaining machine oil and get your wok ready for its first layer of seasoning. Finally, give the entire thing another scrub with soapy water, Dry it carefully and rub the surface inside and out with a very light coating of oil, whatever high-heat-friendly neutral oil you like to use, such as canola, grapeseed, rice bran, or peanut, using a paper towel held in tongs. After use, avoid scrubbing the wok unless absolutely necessary. Usually, a rinse and a rubdown with a soft sponge are all that's needed. Purists may tell you not to use soap. I do, and my wok is still well-seasoned and completely nonstick. Once it's rinsed, dry the wok with a kitchen towel or paper towels and rub some vegetable oil into the surface to give it a vapor-proof coating that will prevent it from rusting. Question: so how do I season it, and do I really need to? Meat proteins can form direct chemical bonds with raw iron or steel. This is not good if you don't want your wok to look like a stucco wall after cooking in it. Just as with a cast iron or carbon steel pan, seasoning your wok and keeping it well seasoned will prevent this, but there is a fundamental difference between seasoning a wok and seasoning a Western skillet. It's important to understand the two different products of heating an oiled piece of ferrous material. The first product is black oxide, a reaction that occurs on the surface of the metal, causing it to turn black. The second is the formation of a layer of polymers as oil breaks down with heat. In a Western skillet, this formation of polymers in increasingly thick layers is what gives it its nonstick properties, and those layers should generally be maintained. With a wok, it's possible to build up those layers as well, but many cooking techniques, such as braising or even rapidly adjusting the heat during a stir-fry, will cause those layers of polymers to break down or flake off. This is okay. The seasoning in a wok mainly comes down to that layer of black oxide, and that layer can be built with each use. With proper preheating and technique, even an omelet should slip and slide without a thick layer of polymers coating the wok. Some people recommend rigorous, extended processes for building up black oxide and polymers, but I suggest you can do it the way I do it. After that initial rub down with oil, just cook in the darn thing. Stick to relatively dry stir-fries and deep-frying for the first several uses to ensure that a decent layer of seasoning has built up. Once your pan is black and shiny, you can safely steam, braise, simmer, or smoke in it. Question: wow, my wok is so well-seasoned, thanks. Now, how do I keep this lustrous beauty lustrous and beautiful? Answer: there's really not much to it. After you're done cooking, clean your wok. This is easiest to do when the wok is still hot, and it only takes a matter of seconds. A light scrub with a bamboo brush, a little soap and water is all it takes. Don't worry, modern soaps are quite mild and will only remove oils without affecting your polymerized seasoning or black oxide. Once your wok is clean, dry it carefully. Water is the enemy of carbon steel and cast iron, and you don't want it rusting on you. Next, set it over a burner and heat it up empty until every drop of moisture is gone from every part of its surface. Finally, rub it with a little fresh oil using a paper towel to protect it. The thinnest layer is all you want to prevent your wok from getting sticky. I like to rub oil into it, then pretend I made a mistake and try to wipe off as much oil as I can with a paper towel. Wok accessories. The round shape of a wok is not designed for straight, narrow Western cooking implements, so you'll need to outfit your new wok with a couple of inexpensive tools. Here are my recommendations, in order of importance. The most important tool is a chuan, or spatula. These spatulas have a wide head and a gently curved lip designed to fit snugly with your wok, allowing you to easily pick up and flip large quantities of food with minimal effort. Look for spatulas at least 14 inches long, made from steel or wood. You can order them online for about $10 a piece. Plenty of bowls for mise en place. Cooking in a wok is a fast process, but most wok-cooked dishes use more ingredients than your average Western recipe, which means a collection of small bowls for prepared ingredients and sauces, is absolutely essential to successful wok cooking. No need to get fancy. I keep a large stack of little metal and ceramic bowls from the restaurant supply shop. They nest and stack, take up very little storage space, and are indestructible. This is important when you inevitably toss a bowl across the kitchen toward the sink after emptying it into your wok. A bamboo brush is the best tool for scrubbing out your wok or even your Western skillets, and can be found inexpensively online or at any Asian supermarket. A wire mesh spider is essential for deep frying or simmering. I like a stainless steel spider with a basket on the larger side, between 5 and 6 inches, to make it easy to tend to little nuggets of fried chicken or a big mess of noodles. A couple of bamboo steamer baskets will convert your wok to a multi-level steamer, and they make for great serving vessels as well. I'd recommend a couple of 10 or 12-inch baskets. They're designed to stack, so you can always order another if you find that two isn't enough for your steaming needs. A lid is not strictly necessary, but it makes tasks that require trapping vapor, such as braising or smoking, easier. You can always use the lid from a large saucepan to cover your wok. Because a wok has tapered sides, pretty much any lid with a diameter less than that of the wok will work. It does not need to fit perfectly. In restaurants, you may see Chinese chefs using a wide ladle called a hok to add splashes of various sauces to serve soupier dishes or to break up clumps of rice or noodles when stir-frying. I personally don't find a hok to be particularly useful in a home setting, where you'll have already measured and mixed your sauces and will be cooking in batches intended to be served all at once instead of ladled out piecemeal. For times when you really need one, a Western ladle will do just fine. A Japanese-style mandolin will make certain difficult bits of knife work much, much easier. In particular, a mandolin is great for making the initial cuts for julienned vegetables, such as the carrots for Sichuan dry-fried beef or the ginger matchsticks in Gongbao Ji Ding. I use the standard model from Benriner, an inexpensive Japanese brand that is razor-sharp, has minimal moving parts. Fancier models with lots of mechanical bits tend to fail pretty quickly, and is infinitely adjustable with a simple screw. It also comes with julienne attachments, though using them drastically increases the odds of injury. I speak from experience. Small plastic squeeze bottles and pour spouts for commonly used sauces are great once you are comfortable enough to start eyeballing and improvising stir fries. I keep light and dark soy sauce and sesame oil in their own squeeze bottles, and I top my Shaoxing wine and sake bottles with metal pour spouts for easy access during a cook. Question: what if I don't have a wok? Answer: most of the recipes in this book will work reasonably well in a larger skillet, or better yet, a large slope-sided saucier pan, a saucepan with gently curved corners. So, if that's all you've got, by all means use them. That said, get a wok. They are inexpensive, mostly indestructible, and will make a noticeable difference in the quality of your food. Knives. A good knife is a tool you'll use virtually every time you cook. Good doesn't have to mean expensive, though. Knives come in a dizzying array of sizes, shapes, and styles. Although many chefs, including me, collect or fetishize knives and pay careful attention to metal types, Rockwell hardness ratings, production methods, and other features, the reality is, once you get past a certain base level of quality, the best knife is the one that you feel comfortable using every day. My advice is to go to a decent knife or kitchen goods store and try a few out to see how they feel. As a bare minimum, look for knives that are forged rather than stamped. Stamped steel will have a uniform thickness from spine to cutting edge, while forged knives are more carefully shaped for better performance. Forged knives also tend to be better balanced and have harder blades that retain their edge longer. your preference in knife is likely going to fall into one of four camps. Western-style chef's knife. A traditional Western-style chef's knife is an all-purpose knife that has a curved blade designed to allow you to hold your free hand on the top edge of the knife and rock the knife back and forth as you cut. It typically has a relatively thick spine compared to its blade length. These are heavy knives that are great for splitting hard vegetables like squashes or for hacking apart chicken carcasses. Recommendation? My choice, Wusthof Classic 8 or 10 inch chef's knife, about $150. Best bang for the buck, Mac HB85 French chef's knife, about $70. Best budget knife, Mercer Culinary Genesis, about $30. Santoku. Santoku knives are the everyday multi-purpose knife of Japan. They have blades with either a very gently curving cutting edge or no curve at all. They are designed for more of an up-and-down chopping motion rather than rocking. They also tend to have thinner, shorter blades than their Western counterparts. Many cooks with smaller hands or who like to feel a little more precision in their knife work prefer Santoku knives. Recommendation? My choice, Misono UX10 Santoku, about $190. Best bang for the buck, Tojiro DP 6.7-inch Santoku, about $70. Best budget knife, Mercer Culinary Asian Collection Santoku, about $25. Gyuto. Gyuto knives are an East-West hybrid that have become increasingly popular among chefs and home cooks. They typically have the length of a Western chef's knife, but have a shallower curve and a far thinner, lighter blade. These types of knives are my personal preference, offering a good compromise. They're nearly as precise as a Santoku, as long and nearly as powerful as a Western knife, and have the ability to perform both chopping and rocking motions. Recommendation? My choice, Kan Core Chef's Knife, about $140. Best bang for the buck, Tojiro DP 8.2-inch Gyuto, about $80. Best budget knife? There are not many very cheap Gyuto-style knives. Chinese cleaver. Chinese cleavers are the chef's knives of China. Thinner and lighter than a bulky Western-style cleaver designed to hack through bones, Chinese cleavers have a rectangular shape with a very gently curved cutting edge and a height that can extend to several inches, giving you plenty of knuckle clearance. They take a lot of getting used to if you've never used one. As with a Santoku, they're used with a chopping or slicing motion as opposed to rocking. Their height and wide surface offer a few advantages. They are excellent for smashing ingredients like garlic or ginger before chopping, and for transferring prepared ingredients from one place to another. Recommendation? You're unlikely to find Chinese-style cleavers at Western cookware stores, but if you've got a good Asian knife shop or a Chinatown nearby, take a look and shop around until you find something that fits you comfortably. I use a Shibashi 9-inch stainless steel Chinese chef's knife, which you can find online for around $40. A rice cooker or multi-cooker? There's a reason you'll find big rice cookers in nearly every Japanese or Chinese restaurant and countertop models in Asian kitchens. They're inexpensive and really good at cooking rice. Sure, it's relatively easy to cook rice on the stovetop, but the rice cooker does it perfectly, consistently, and inexpensively at the touch of a button. If you eat rice a few times a week, a rice cooker, or better yet, an electric countertop multi-cooker like an Instant Pot, is a worthwhile investment. Sidebar. Got an electric or induction burner? You can still stir-fry. For the longest time, I didn't think stir-frying was possible on an electric burner. But it is, and in some cases, it can even be easier than working with a gas range. You just need to make a few adjustments. The key difference between electric and gas ranges is that gas ranges have flames that shoot up, heating the wok even if it is not in direct contact with the burner. This means that even while you are shaking and tossing your food, the wok is getting essentially the same amount of heat input as if it were sitting still. An electric or induction range requires direct contact for heating. This means that the wok needs to sit relatively still and flat against the burner for it to have any effect. Practically, this means for electric or induction cooktops, you'll want to cook in even smaller batches, as little as, say, a quarter pound of meat at a time. This is not a problem. It just means your stir-fry will take a little bit longer. Get the wok smoking hot, cook the batch of meat, transfer it to a bowl, wipe out the wok, and repeat until all your meat is seared and in the bowl. Next, do the same for all your vegetables. Finally, heat up the wok again, stir-fry your aromatics, add the meat and vegetables back to the pan along with your sauce, toss to coat and to reduce a bit, and you're good to go. The other simple solution is to purchase an inexpensive portable gas range. You can find many models that run off butane canisters online or at any Asian supermarket. I'm partial to the 15,000 BTU per hour Iwatani ZA3HP burner, available online, for its high output and sturdy design. I'm not going to come out and tell you that it's perfectly safe to use them indoors on your kitchen counter, but I'm also not going to come into your home and stop you if you decide to do it. Just make sure you have good clearance around the flame and canister, and keep your fire extinguisher handy. A good idea no matter what kind of stir-frying you're doing. Stocking a wok-friendly pantry. Many Asian recipes and techniques rely on a large number of seasoning sauces, pastes, pickles, and spices to add complexity and depth to even the fastest of recipes. There's no way around it. If you're new to Asian cooking, you're gonna have to stock up your pantry. This section covers the ingredients I use most. The first time you decide to fire up the wok, you may have some sticker shock from the number of bottles and sauces you need for even a very basic stir-fry. The good news is that, individually, most of these ingredients are cheap, and nearly all of them last for a long time. With proper storage, most will last years without a big loss in quality. Hit an Asian market or an online source once to load up, and you'll be good to go for quite a while. If you just want to dip your feet in, your best bet is to browse the chapters, find some recipes that speak to you, and start from there. In this section, I've labeled all of the pantry ingredients as beginner, that is, you'll use them all the time, intermediate, nice to have for certain dishes, or advanced, used in only very specific cases. Soy sauces. Soy sauce is the staple seasoning of most East Asian countries, and it has been for several thousand years. It's made by inoculating a cooked mixture of soybeans and wheat with koji, the Japanese name for the numerous molds of the genus Aspergillus, allowing it to incubate, then fermenting it further in a wet brine. The koji breaks down starches into simple sugars and proteins into amino acids, while lactic fermentation in the salt brine further transforms those sugars into lactic acid. The resulting dark brown sludge is pressed to remove solids, and a thin, salty, deeply flavorful dark sauce is the result. High-quality sauces are typically aged after brewing, while more inexpensive sauces may be bottled immediately for sale. The cheapest products sold as soy sauce at the supermarket, such as La Choy brand, are made with hydrolyzed soy protein, corn syrup, and artificial colors. Their flavor only loosely resembles the real deal. I avoid them. Check the ingredients list, and if it contains any of those, leave it on the shelf. If your bottle says naturally brewed, you're in good shape. Japanese soy sauce is made with a mixture of soy and grain, which gives it a thinner texture and sweeter flavor than Chinese sauces. Japanese soy sauce shoyu, comes in two main varieties, koikuchi, dark, and usukuchi, light. Chinese soy sauces also come in dark and light varieties, but light Chinese soy sauce is more similar in flavor and color to koikuchi sauce than usukuchi. For everyday use, I keep a jug of kikkoman in my fridge, refilling a smaller squeeze bottle as needed, as well as a bottle of Pearl River brand Chinese dark soy sauce. Once opened, soy sauce can be stored in a cool, dark cabinet for several months or in the fridge for a year or more. It will eventually start to develop unpleasant, fishy aromas. Of the varieties of soy sauce listed later, all have some uses, but one bottle of koikuchi shoyu and one bottle of Chinese dark soy sauce will keep you well-equipped for nearly any situation. Usukuchi shoyu, Japan, is useful for when you want to season vegetables or fish without giving them a distinct dark color, but I use it at home only for a few specific uses, such as over cold tofu or in tamago kake gohan. It tends to be quite salty, and due to the addition of mirin, a sweet rice wine, acidic. How important is it? Advanced. Substitute? None. Brand recommendation? Yamasa. Koikuchi shoyu, Japan, is the more common variety, and even though it appears darker and thicker, it actually has a lighter flavor than usukuchi soy sauce. It's my jack-of-all-trades. It can be used in sauces, in marinades, in dips and stir-fries, or for seasoning soups and broths. I keep a bottle of kikkoman's all-purpose in my fridge for cooking, and a few fancier bottles for sushi and other situations where soy sauce is the only seasoning. That bottle, by the way, doesn't say koikuchi on it. Unless a bottle is specifically labeled usukuchi, it's most likely a koikuchi. How important is it? Essential. Substitutes, Chinese light soy sauce or tamari. Brand recommendation, kikkoman. Tamari, Japan, is another type of Japanese soy sauce typically made with 100% soybeans, or close to it. It has a harsher flavor than shoyu, but can be used in place of shoyu for folks with wheat sensitivity. Check the bottle. Some tamari actually contains wheat. How important is it? Essential only for gluten-free cooking. Substitutes, kokuchi shoyu or Chinese light soy sauce. Brand recommendation, Sanjay. Chinese light soy sauce. Also known as thin or fresh soy sauce, Chinese light soy sauce is made very similarly to Japanese koikuchi sauces, though often with a lower proportion of wheat. And here's where naming conventions between Japanese and Chinese sauces can get a little confusing. What's labeled light soy sauce in the Chinese aisle is more similar to Japanese dark soy sauce, koikuchi, than it is to Japanese light soy sauce, usukuchi. It's the most common sauce for traditional Chinese stir-fries, but you can use shoyu instead. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitutes, koikuchi shoyu or tamari. Brand recommendation, Pearl River Bridge. Chinese dark soy sauce. Chinese dark soy sauce is thicker, sweeter, less salty, and, well, darker than light soy sauce. It frequently contains added molasses or caramel coloring to give it its distinct dark color. Tasted raw, it's not particularly pleasant or interesting, but the flavor develops through cooking. Rather than dipping, Chinese dark soy sauce is primarily used for braising or stir-frying. How important is it? Essential. Substitute? None. Brand recommendation? Pearl River Bridge. Ketchup manis, Indonesia. Ketchup is the Indonesian term for any kind of fermented sauce, and of Malay origin is thought to be the source of both the word and the sauce ketchup in the West. Ketchup manis is the most common form of soy sauce in Indonesia, used in stir-fries like bami or nasi goreng, fried noodles and rice, respectively, and in stews like babi ketchup, soy sauce braised pork. It's got a thick, syrupy texture and a sweet, complex flavor due to the addition of palm sugar and spices. If you can't find it, you can make it yourself quite easily. See the recipe on page 291. How important is it? Advanced. Substitute, homemade. Brand recommendation, ABC Indonesian sweet soy sauce. Other sauces and pastes. Oyster sauce. A thick, slightly sweet sauce made with oyster extract. It has a rich, savory complexity. If you've seen Lee Kum Kee brand products on the supermarket shelf, this is what put them on the map. It was invented in 1888 by the founder of the company, Lee Kum Sheng, apocryphally when he accidentally left a pot of oysters simmering over a burner until it reduced to a rich gravy. It's used widely in Chinese and Thai cuisine, as well as in Vietnam and Malaysia. These days, Lee Kum Kee has two grades. The red bottle with a panda on it is made with oyster extract and other flavorings, while the blue bottle with the picture of two boys on a fishing boat labeled Premium Oyster Sauce is made the traditional way, with more oyster flavor. There are many other brands of oyster sauce. So long as oyster extract is listed among the first ingredients, any brand should do fine for the recipes in this book. Because oysters are so rich in glutamates and inosinates, the family of compounds responsible for umami flavor, it's used to bring out the savoriness of a wide range of dishes, from stir-fried fish to steamed or stir-fried green vegetables, or in Chinese-American cashew chicken. How important is it? Essential. Substitute? None. Brand recommendation? Lee Kum Kee. Doubanjiang, Sichuan broad bean chili sauce. Doubanjiang, or fermented broad bean chili sauce, is an essential sauce in Sichuan cuisine. It's a very salty sauce made with fermented broad beans, soybeans, rice, and chilies. Some varieties do not include chilies, but I've never seen a chili-free version sold in the United States. It's the backbone of dishes like mapo tofu or shuiju nuro, water-boiled beef. It also makes for a quick and easy addition to plain noodles. Try stirring a bit into your instant ramen, rice, or tofu. Compared to other jarred sauces, it's extremely salty and powerfully flavored. A little bit goes a long way. There is a huge difference in quality between the best versions of this sauce, which are made in Pixian, and mass-market ones such as Lee Kum Kee's version. The former is dark red and oily, with whole fermented broad beans and a deep, roasty chili flavor, while the latter tend to be more wet and paste-like and will not fry or stain your stir-fry oil red properly. This is the only essential pantry ingredient that you will most likely have to order online, but it's inexpensive and lasts forever in the fridge. You'll probably come across products with the label China Time-Honored Brand on them, which is similar to European traditional product denotations, indicating that it is produced using a stringent set of traditional standards. According to Chris Liang of Mala Foods, in the case of Doubanjiang, that includes the types of chilies, Erjing Tiao, harvested from July to the 15th day of lunar autumn, the types of beans, broad beans, fermented for at least 6 months and over a summer, and the period of secondary fermentation, at least 3 months. How important is it? Essential. Substitute? None. Brand recommendations? Wancheng Pixian Doubanjiang, a China time-honored brand, Dan, or any brand made in Pixian. Hoisin sauce. One of many sauces based on fermented soybeans, it has a sweet and salty flavor, similar to American-style barbecue sauce. It can be used just like barbecue sauce by painting it onto pork ribs or shoulder toward the end of cooking, though its range of uses goes far beyond roasted meats. It's commonly served with Peking duck or with mushu pork. In southern Vietnam, you might stir some into your bowl of pho. It pairs great with chili oil, Try brushing that mix onto the inside of a tortilla before making a quesadilla. Trust me. How important is it? Essential. Substitute? None. Brand recommendations? Li Kum Ki or Kun Chun. Tian Mian Jiang, sweet fermented bean pastes. Tian Mian Jiang translates literally as sweet noodle sauce, and you'll find a wide variety of sweet bean pastes in both Chinese and Korean cuisines. Despite the name, sweet bean pastes typically contain more wheat flour than soybeans. They have a sweet, savory flavor with a funky backbone. Think of Tian Mian Jiang as hoisin sauce for experts. You'll see jars labeled sweet bean paste and ground bean paste, and while subtly different in flavor, I typically keep only one in my pantry. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitute, hoisin sauce. Brand recommendation, Kun Chung bean sauce. Duchi, Chinese black beans and black bean sauce. Duchi is the funkiest and oldest. Archaeologists have found fermented black beans from 165 BC of the fermented beans. They're made by fermenting a black variety of soybean with salt. The resulting beans are salty, funky, and semi-moist with a soft texture. You can find them sold whole in roughly ground sauces flavored with garlic and in smooth sauces. The whole beans are the most versatile, but if you're going to have only one type of fermented black bean, I'd suggest a jar of Li Kum Ki black bean garlic sauce, which saves you the trouble of chopping the whole beans yourself and can be incorporated as is into stir fries and other dishes. Rare is the occasion when I don't want garlic in a dish with black beans. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitute, dark miso paste in a real pinch. Brand recommendations, Li Kum Ki for sauce, Kun Chun for whole black beans. Gochujang, Korean fermented chili paste. Gochujang, with its deep red color, looks like it's going to blow your head off with heat, but this popular Korean sauce is actually only moderately spicy. The fermented chilies that go into it are balanced with sweet, glutinous rice and powdered fermented black soybeans. It's great in simple dressings for fresh vegetables. Try cucumbers with soy sauce and gochujang, and it's an essential flavor in sundubu jjigae, Korean tofu soup, dakbukki, rice cakes simmered with gochujang, and bibimbap, topped mixed rice. It's also a great ingredient to have on hand for sauces and marinades, as its smooth texture allows it to incorporate into sauces easily, while lending them body to cling to food. How important is it? Essential. Substitute? None. Brand recommendations? Suncheong or Haechandol. Fish sauce. Fish sauce is the predominant seasoning in Thai, Vietnamese, Cambodian, Lao, Philippine, Malaysian, Indonesian, and Burmese cuisines. It's made by fermenting anchovies with salt, then straining the resultant liquid. In its raw, undiluted form, it can smell powerful. But incorporated into dishes, it brings out a level of flavor you never knew existed. It's loaded with umami-rich compounds, even more than soy sauce, which adds savory depth to all kinds of food, ranging from condiments to salad dressings, marinades, soups, stews, and stir-fries. And it's not just useful for Southeast Asian cuisine. I regularly add a bit of fish sauce to any meaty Western-style stew, like beef stew, chili, or even ragu bolognese. Just don't tell your Italian grandmother, where its fishy aroma blends completely into the background. Chili with fish sauce doesn't taste like fish. It just tastes like extra tasty chili. How important is it? Essential. Substitute? None. Brand recommendations? Tiporo, Red Boat, Golden Boy, or Tra Chang. Though honestly, most any brand will do. Miso. All miso is made through the same basic process. A grain or a pulse, typically soybeans, though barley, rice, millet, rye, and more recently chickpeas and quinoa, is ground and fermented with salt and the fungus Aspergillus oryzae, koji in Japanese. The resulting protein-rich paste has a salty, savory flavor that can range from heavy and funky to light and mildly sweet. Typically, the darker the color of the miso, the higher the proportion of soybeans used, and the stronger the flavor. How important is it? Essential. Substitute, Korean tengjang. Brand recommendations, Eden Foods, Shirakiku, Miso Boom, or Miko. Tengjang, Korean fermented soybean paste. Similar in appearance and flavor to Japanese dark miso, tengjang is a Korean fermented paste made from 100% soybeans. On its own, it can be used in marinades and soup bases, but you'll most frequently see it combined with gochujang, garlic, sesame oil, sugar, and scallions to make the sauce samjang, the sauce that you've probably dabbed onto the leafy greens you eat with Korean barbecue. How important is it? Advanced. Substitute, miso paste. Brand recommendations, sunchang or haechundal. Sambal ulek, Indonesian chili sauce. Traditional Indonesian sambals are similar to Thai namprik, thick, relish-like condiments made in a mortar and pestle. The simplest are made with chilies and salt, though they can become far more complex with other ingredients like garlic, ginger, and shrimp paste. The California-based Hoi Fong, yes, the same company with the green rooster logo that makes the ubiquitous sriracha, makes a version that is fresh, spicy, and great as a table condiment. I use it as a table condiment to add fresh heat to a wide variety of dishes, from noodles and stir-fries to Western dishes like fried eggs or grits. How important is it? N.A. I use it as a condiment, not for cooking. Substitute? Any bright, chunky, chili-forward hot sauce you like. Brand recommendation? Hoi Fong. Roasted sesame paste. A thick paste made from toasted sesame seeds that is widely used in sauces, salads, noodles, and dips. Like fresh peanut or almond butter, it splits as it sits, so you need to give it a good stir before using, and if you let it sit too long, you'll really have to work at scraping up the bottom of the jar. Tahini is a very similar Middle Eastern, Western, Mediterranean condiment that is typically made with fresh, not roasted, sesame seeds. The Chinese stuff has a stronger, nuttier aroma and flavor, but tahini works just fine if it's all you can find, especially if you fried the tahini first. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitutes, tahini or fried tahini. Brand recommendation, Hoi Fong. Tamarind. Tamarind is an intensely sour tropical fruit that is cultivated around the world. If you've ever tasted the sweet-sour brown chutney commonly found at the Indian lunch buffet, you know it. It's one of the essential flavors of pad thai and is used in drinks and sauces throughout Latin America. You'll find tamarind sold in whole fruit, fruit pulp, paste, and concentrate. Any of those forms will work. Follow instructions on jars of concentrate for dilution before using. Whole fruits should have their hard, dry outer husk removed before the sticky, pulpy interior is used. Tamarind paste is easy to make at home by placing tamarind fruit pulp in a bowl with a roughly equal volume of warm water and working it with your fingers until it forms a thick paste. Push this paste through a fine mesh strainer with a spatula, and it's recipe ready. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitute? None. Brand recommendation? Mechua. Shrimp paste. Fermented shrimp paste is commonly used in curries, sauces, soups, marinades, and dips like namprik or sambal. Like fish sauce, it has a pungent, fishy aroma. Unlike in fish sauce, the fermented shrimp are ground, not strained, which gives the finished paste a grainy texture and very powerful aroma that sticks around even in finished dishes. It's what gives Malaysian fried chicken its distinct flavor and aroma. It adds layers of flavor to some versions of satay. In the markets I've seen in the United States, it's generally sold labeled belacan or kapi, the Malay and Thai words for shrimp paste, respectively. How important is it? Advanced. Substitute? None. Brand recommendations? Tra Chang and Old Man make powerful versions. Lee Kum Kee makes a milder version that is better if you have an aversion to strong, fishy aromas. Vinegars. Acid. Where would we be without acid? 9 out of 10 chemists and chefs agree. Acid is essential. Like salt, sugar, umami, bitterness, and spiciness, acid is sensed directly in your mouth and on your tongue. But it's also unique. Most acidic foods give off vapors that tickle our noses, perking them up and helping boost our reception of other aromas. Ever notice how that vinegary whiff of buffalo sauce or the swirl of vinegar in your hot and sour soup immediately gets your saliva flowing? Even thinking about a bag of salt and vinegar potato chips will do it. Your mouth is watering right now, isn't it? Acid helps to balance out richness, making dishes taste lighter and more palatable. And, of course, most culinary acids, whether made from fruits, wine, or grains, also bring a host of flavors with them. Finishing vinegars made with infusions or by aging in wooden barrels can add more layers of complexity. Next to salt, acid is the most important element when seasoning food. But seasoning with acid works in a fundamentally different way. The right amount of salt to add to a dish generally fits within a pretty narrow window. Most people find around 1 to 1.5% by weight to be the most palatable range. In restaurants, especially those that want to sell you more beverages, you're more likely getting food pushing into the 2% salt range. Acidity, on the other hand, can vary wildly. Some foods taste great with a ton of acid, the vinegar in hot and sour soup, or that Chinese-American staple, General Tso's chicken. Some dishes just need a splash. Traditional Kung Pao chicken, or the corner of a dumpling dipped in black vinegar. Some need no additional acid at all. Fried rice and beef chow fun contain no extra acid other than what comes with the other ingredients. Acids play an important role in Asian foods in particular, where all sorts of grains, fruits, and vegetables are fermented into vinegar or other condiments. Properly closed bottles of vinegar can be stored in a cool, dark pantry nearly indefinitely. Distilled white vinegar. Distilled white vinegar is typically made from ethanol and is designed to be neutral in flavor. Its main use is to add sharp acidity for preservation or flavor in dishes where a strong aroma or other flavors might compete. It typically has an acidity level of around 5% acetic acid. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitutes: white wine or rice vinegar. Brand recommendation: they're all identical. Rice vinegar. Many vinegars are made from rice, but when I say rice vinegar, I'm typically talking about the clear to pale yellow stuff. Like most Asian vinegars, it's not as powerfully acidic tasting as most Western vinegars and is diluted to a lower overall acetic acid content than most Western vinegars, about 3.5% versus 5%. I typically use Marukan, an inexpensive Japanese brand with decent flavor. Several Chinese brands are also widely available in the States. One thing, be careful what you pick up. Seasoned rice vinegar is an entirely different product, which has had sugar, salt, and seasonings added to it. It's intended to be used as is for seasoning rice for sushi, but it's not really useful in other cooking applications. How important is it? Essential. Substitute. In a big pinch, you can use apple cider vinegar, which has a similarly low-acid, slightly sweet flavor. Brand recommendation: Marukan. Black vinegar. This is hands down my favorite vinegar. Black vinegar is a class of vinegars made in China that are mildly acidic, highly aromatic and fruity, and very dark in color, like soy sauce. My favorite type of black vinegar is Chinkyang vinegar, which originated in coastal Jiangsu province just north of Shanghai. It makes a wonderful dipping sauce for all manner of dim sum. It's the sour in your hot and sour soup, and it brightens up countless stir-fries, soups, and stews. Because of its long aging process and the flavor from the gradual addition of rice hulls, it achieves a complex, almost balsamic-like flavor. You can easily find it at Chinese grocers or on online retailers. How important is it? Intermediate, but once you taste it, you'll want it on everything. Substitute: equal parts balsamic vinegar, red wine vinegar, and water. Brand recommendations: Sios or Gold Plum. Sidebar: the pH scale. Acidity is measured on the pH scale, which typically ranges from 1, most acidic, to 14, most alkaline. A pH of 7 is considered neutral. pH is measured on a logarithmic rather than linear scale. That is, a liquid with a pH of 4 will be 10 times more acidic than a liquid with a pH of 5. When experimenting in the kitchen, check the pH of your added liquids, especially if you plan to use them in a marinade. If it's anywhere below about 4 to 4.5, it's a good idea to dilute it well or to not let your meat marinate for more than half an hour or so. Ingredient: lime juice. Average pH, lower pH equals higher acidity. Lime juice, 2.1. Lemon juice, 2.2. Distilled white vinegar, 2.4. Rice vinegar, 2.6. Verjus, 2.6. White wine vinegar, 2.7. Red wine vinegar, 2.7. Cider vinegar, 3.4. Honey, 3.9. Balsamic vinegar, 4. Chinese black vinegar, 4. Chinkyang vinegar, 4. Whiskey, 4. Dry sherry, 4. Shaoxing wine, 4.2. Sake, 4.2. Beer, 4.3. Molasses, 5. Water, 7. Fats and oils. As with most foods, heat, light, and air are the enemies of oil and can cause it to turn rancid. A general rule of thumb is that the more flavorful the oil, the more easily it will go bad and the more precaution you should take while storing it. To cut down on costs and improve shelf life, I buy most of my oils in large tins or tinted plastic bottles and store them in a cool, dark cabinet. For use, I use a funnel to fill and refill a set of dark tinted glass bottles of varying sizes fitted with pour spouts. The oils I use most go in emptied and cleaned green wine bottles, while the oils I use less frequently go in the smaller bottles I bought online. After that, I do something shocking. I store the bottles I use most on the countertop next to my stove. I know I shouldn't. I'm pretty sure I've even told people not to. But hear me out. While it's true that the heat from the stove can prematurely cause oil stored nearby to turn rancid, it still takes weeks for this to happen, which is typically more than enough time for me to finish and replenish a stock. In the 5 years I've been doing this regularly, I've only once had to throw out some canola oil that had become rancid. It's a small price to pay for years of convenience. Just don't put them straight on the burner or in the path of rising heat and vapors, okay? Stir-fry or deep-fry oil. Stir-fries require oil that can be heated to a high temperature without breaking down too much. Canola, grapeseed, rice bran, and safflower are widely available and work great for stir-fries. Deep-frying works better with an oil with a relatively high saturated fat content, which improves crisping. I use peanut or soybean oil, though sometimes I'll use more inexpensive canola oil for deep frying. How important is it? Essential. Substitutes: any neutral high-temperature frying oil, such as vegetable or avocado. Brand recommendation: any. Roasted sesame oil. This oil, made from roasted sesame seeds, is an essential flavoring in many Chinese, Korean, and Japanese dishes. It can be used to add aroma to finished soups and sauces. It can flavor dumpling fillings. It's used to season stir-fries or marinate meats. And it can be used in dressings. Roasted sesame oil tends to be very prone to rancidity, so I keep a sealed tin in the pantry and use it to refill a small plastic squeeze bottle that I keep in the fridge. How important is it? Essential. Substitute? None. Brand recommendation? Kadoya. Saizayo, roasted rapeseed oil. Saizayo is an oil expressed from cultivars of the same plant, rapeseed, used to produce canola oil. Unlike canola oil, which has a neutral flavor, saizayo has a rich, nutty, toasted aroma that reminds me of roasted barley with a hint of mustard. It's the cooking oil of choice in Sichuan, and if you've ever thought that your chili oil or mapo tofu is lacking a certain flavor you get only at your favorite Sichuanese restaurant, saizayo is most likely the answer. Unfortunately, it's also very difficult to find in the United States. I've discovered it at one Chinese megamart in Seattle, Asian Family Market, but nowhere else, including in New York and San Francisco. You can order it online via Mala Market, though it can be a little pricey. The other problem is that it can be tough to identify, as it's typically simply labeled canola oil or rapeseed oil. Visually, saizayo will have a much darker brownish-yellow color than standard canola oil, which is how I identify it at the market. If you cannot find saizayo, peanut oil will work in its place, but it will not have quite the same flavor properties. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitutes: a combination of canola and Indian mustard seed oil, or peanut oil. Brand recommendation: your selection will be limited, so whatever you can find. Ryu, or other simple or clear chili oils. Chili oil is made by infusing a neutral oil with dried chilies. They can range in heat, but are typically not insanely spicy. Instead, they're more about adding a dash of that sweet roasted chili flavor to noodles, soups, and dipping sauce. Ryu is the Japanese version, and it comes in small bottles with a push top designed for dispensing drops of oil over ramen. You can also find Chinese brands in larger bottles, with or without chili sediment. Clear chili oil can be stored in a cool, dark pantry if you use it within about a year, or in the fridge otherwise. Chili oil with sediment should be stored in the fridge after being opened. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitute: the clear oil from the top of a batch of Sichuan Mala chili oil. Brand recommendation: S&B La Yu. Crispy chili oils. There is a wide range of crispy chili oils, that is, unstrained chili oil with a large volume of chili and other aromatic debris left in the bottle, from mild Japanese varieties to hotter Chinese oils. Remember when people were putting Hoi Fong Sriracha on everything? I sure remember. Thankfully, those days are over, and we've now started spooning Sichuan Spicy Chili Crisp, specifically Lao Gan Ma brand, on everything. I'm appreciative of the upgrade, though I still question why we collectively must have one sauce to rule them all. Lao Gan Ma has a few more ingredients than typical crispy chili oils, including peanuts and citrusy Sichuan peppercorns. At the table, I use it in noodle dishes and soups, on dumplings and other dim sum, and on fried rice and other stir fries. It's even great on vanilla ice cream. Really. The one big drawback of some of the pre-bottled stuff is shelf life. On more than one occasion, I've opened brand new bottles of Lao Gan Ma to reveal fishy-smelling rancid oil inside. After opening, it should be stored sealed in the refrigerator between uses. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitutes: Sichuan Mala chili oil. Brand recommendations: Momoya chili oil with fried garlic for mild, Lao Gan Ma Spicy Chili Crisp for hot, and Mom's Mala for Sichuan-style hot and numbing flavors. Sichuan Pepper Oil. Sichuan peppercorns are the hull of the fruit of the prickly ash. It lends its citrusy aroma and mouth-numbing properties to many northern Chinese dishes. While Sichuan pepper oil is not a substitute for actual seeds, it does a nice job of adding a quick hit of aroma and numbingness to a stir-fry or dip without the need to pick through and grind fresh Sichuan peppercorn. Think of it as a cheaty route to mala, hot and numbing dishes. You can buy it in most Asian supermarkets as well as online. Store the bottle in the fridge or a dark, cool pantry between uses. How important is it? Advanced. Brand recommendations, Sayos or Li Hong. Booze. As in many European cuisines, various types of wine and other alcoholic fermented products are widely used in marinades, sauces, braises, and soups. When added to dishes during cooking, booze can add an extra layer of flavor and a bit of acidity that enhances the existing flavors in a dish. Alcohol is also useful for drawing out flavors from fat-soluble compounds that wouldn't otherwise be drawn out by water and water-based liquids like stock. Shaoxing wine. Shaoxing wine is an amber-colored type of huangju, fermented rice wine, that comes from the city of Shaoxing in eastern China. With a light amber color and a sweet, mildly oxidized aroma, it's been mentioned in recorded history for over 2,000 years and is nearly ubiquitous in meat-based Chinese dishes. I haven't counted, but I'd take even odds that it's in at least 75% of the recipes in this book. It's typically used in small quantities for marinating meat or for adding its fragrant aroma to sauces, but some dishes call for lots of it. Red braised dishes like Taiwanese braised short rib noodle soup use cups of it. It's readily available in any Asian market, but if you can't find it, a dry sherry, with its oxidized aroma, is what most closely resembles it. I avoid bottles labeled cooking wine, as those typically have about 1.5% salt added to them, which makes it difficult to manage seasoning in finished dishes, especially if you're going to be reducing the wine, as you often do, and combining it with salty ingredients like soy sauce, as you often do. If it's unavoidable, as it often is, just be aware during final seasoning. Shaoxing wine can be stored in a cool, dark pantry for 6 months or longer. How important is it? Essential. Substitute, dry sherry. Brand recommendations, Sayos or Li Hong. Sake. Japanese sake is brewed in a manner similar to beer. Soaked grains are heated and converted to sugars. Then yeast takes over and converts those sugars to alcohol. For cooking, as with wine in European cuisine, try to pick a sake that is not too rich, not too sweet, and not too expensive. An inexpensive bottle of junmaishu should run you under $10 or so. Ozeki, Shochikubai, and Gekkeikan are three brands of inexpensive sake that are widely available in the United States and are great for cooking. Sake should be refrigerated after opening. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitutes. If called for in quantities under a few tablespoons, a dry white wine can be used. In larger quantities, it's harder to duplicate its unique flavor. Brand recommendations, Ozeki, Shochikubai, and Gekkeikan. Mirin. True mirin is a type of rice wine that is higher proof than sake and made with glutinous rice, also known as sweet rice or sticky rice, that has a sweet, almost honey-like flavor. It's also very difficult to find in the United States. But that's okay. Even in Japan, many households use aji mirin, a product made with sake, corn syrup, or other sweetener, and additional alcohol. Mirin is used extensively in glazes and barbecue sauces. It's what provides sweetness in dishes like teriyaki, grilled eel, or yakiniku, grilled meat. Mirin can be stored in a cool, dark pantry for at least 6 months. I've had large bottles that have lasted a year or more and are still perfectly fine for cooking. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitute. Place 2 cups of sake and 1 cup of sugar in a small saucepan and heat until the sugar is completely dissolved. Use the same way you'd use mirin. Brand recommendations. Kikkoman for aji mirin, Takara for true mirin, if you can find it. Pickled and dried ingredients. Like jarred condiments and sauces, pickled and dried ingredients play an important role in adding quick complexity and flavor to stir-fries, soups, and noodle dishes. Most of these products can easily be ordered online. Pickles. Jiakai. Jiakai are Chinese pickled vegetables, the most famous of which is Sichuan vegetable, the bulbous root of a mustardy brassica that has been fermented with salt and chilies. It comes from Chongqing, that is, Chongqing, a municipality that until 1997 was part of neighboring Sichuan province. It's served sliced into thin slivers in dishes like Sichuan pork and pickle soup, or to top noodle dishes like dandan noodles. In the States, you'll find it sold by weight at better-stocked Chinese supermarkets. It's also sold in markets or online in its whole form in cans or pre-slivered in foil pouches. The latter format is the most convenient, as the packets last forever while sealed and are small enough to easily use up after opening. I buy them online 10 packets at a time. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitutes. Hot marinated olives from the bulk olive section at the supermarket, or mild olives like pitted cherignola, or even canned black olives seasoned with a little chili oil. Brand recommendation, Chongqing Fulin Jiakai. Yakai. Yakai is the pickled stem of a mustard plant from Sichuan. It's similar to jiakai, but has a stronger aroma. If you've had it in the States, it was most likely as an ingredient in Sichuan dry-fried string beans, where it adds a pleasant, crunchy texture and pungent flavor. It's also commonly used as a noodle topping. How important is it? Advanced. Substitutes. Jiakai, or oil-cured olives from the bulk olive section of the supermarket, or a mix of finely minced sauerkraut or kimchi and finely minced capers. Brand recommendation, Yibin Sui Mi Jiakai. Pickled chilies with or without garlic. Hot pickled Thai bird or Sichuan heaven-facing chilies in vinegar are great for adding a quick, bright punch of heat to soups, stir-fries, and noodles. I use them in my Sichuan-style fish-fragrant eggplant or to add heat at the table to pad si iu, Thai-style stir-fried wide rice noodles, and chicken and ginger soup with rice cakes. You can find them on Chinese and Thai supermarket shelves, but they're very easy to make yourself if you have access to fresh hot chilies. Even serrano or jalapeno will work. It takes all of 5 minutes. How important is it? Intermediate. Substitute? Homemade pickled chilies. Brand recommendation? Kok brand. Sidebar. Alcohol, fat, and water. If you've ever made a salad dressing, seen the sheen of motor oil floating on a puddle, or are familiar with very common metaphors, you know that oil and water don't mix. But what about alcohol? And what does the ability of various liquids to mix have to do with flavor? To understand this, you first need to understand a few basic principles. Miscibility is the ability of two liquids to mix together and form an even solution. Alcohol and water, for instance, are miscible. Oil and water are not. Shake up a jar of oil and water, let it sit, and eventually the oil and water will separate, forming distinct layers. But what about alcohol? If alcohol and water weren't miscible, every bottle of 80-proof booze would end up with all the alcohol at the top and all the water at the bottom. But alcohol and fat can also be miscible, depending on the concentration of alcohol and the temperature of the solution. In general, the higher the alcohol content, the more easily oil will mix with it, and the longer it will take for that oil to separate. This all has to do with the polarity of a molecule, that is, the relative charge at either end of it. Molecules that are strongly polar tend to mix well with other molecules that are strongly polar, while those that are neutral mix well with other neutral molecules. Water molecules are highly polar, while oil is nonpolar. Ethanol is an amphipathic molecule, which means that it has a section that's polar and a section that's nonpolar. This allows it to mix to some degree with both water and fat. If your water and that kid in college you never saw eye to eye with is fat, no, not that kind of fat, then alcohol is the stuff that might bridge the gap between you. And, just like in college, the exact degree to which fat will mix into a water-alcohol mixture is related to the alcohol content. The more alcohol, the better things mix. So, what does all this mean for cooking? It's true that the vast majority of alcohol will evaporate during the cooking process. There is always going to be at least a small amount left in the mix, assuming you don't cook it until all the water is also driven off. But this tiny amount is not really enough to help fat mix in. However, because ethanol, the type of alcohol in your wine or whiskey, is less polar than water, some aromatic compounds that are fat-soluble can also be dissolved in alcohol. Adding alcohol to a marinade or to the liquid in a pot as a dish simmers can help draw out more of these fat-soluble compounds, making them more readily available for your nose and tongue to smell and taste. All this stuff is only mildly applicable to day-to-day cooking, but it sure is fun to know. And if I learned anything from G.I. Joe, it's that most problems end with a fight, and that knowing is half the battle. Dry aromatics. Although there are plenty of dishes you can make without any dried spices or other dry pantry goods, they do make their way into many recipes, particularly noodles, soups, curries, and northern Chinese dishes. I buy my dried spices in bulk, either online or from local spice shops, where you can get better deals and fresher spices than the little bottles you find at the supermarket. With few exceptions, I buy all my spices whole rather than ground. Whole spices retain their flavor much longer. Toasting spices whole also develops more complex and varied flavor than trying to toast ground spices, which, due to their high surface area to volume ratio, can quickly lose their aroma. Whole spices also have a much longer shelf life than ground spices. Properly stored in sealed containers in a cool, dark pantry, most spices will retain their flavor for a year or more. Not sure if your spices are too old? Just use your nose. If they don't smell like anything in the bottle, they aren't going to add anything to your food. Sidebar: do I really need to toast my spices? Short answer, no. Even without toasting, so long as your spices are fresh, have been stored properly, and are ground just before use, they're going to pack plenty of flavor. On the other hand, if you want to really maximize complexity and aroma, toasting spices whole before grinding will do that for you. To toast spices, place them in a dry skillet over moderate heat and cook them, stirring and shaking the pan frequently until you can start to smell them. This should take a minute or two. Once they're aromatic, keep going for 30 seconds or so, then transfer them from the skillet to your mortar and pestle and grind away. In some dishes, like stir-fried new potatoes with hot and numbing spices, ground spices are added directly to the dish just before finishing. In others, like Kung Pao Chicken, spices and aromatics are bloomed in hot oil before the remaining stir-fry ingredients are added. In still others, such as Mapo Tofu or Chongqing-style dry-fried chicken, You'll toast whole spices in oil, strain and discard them after they've given their flavor to the oil, then reinforce that flavor with more ground spices added during the final stages of cooking. Question: what spices and nuts do I need? Answer: dry spices play an important role in a wide variety of Asian cuisines, particularly those of northern Thailand and Laos, and in northern Chinese dishes, many of which were heavily influenced by Indian and Middle Eastern cuisines through their position at the end of the Silk Road trade route. Most spices and dried goods I use in this book are easy to find. Here are some of the basics that you can easily find at Western supermarkets or spice vendors: bay leaves, cardamom, coriander seeds, cumin, cloves, cinnamon, fennel, roasted peanuts, white peppercorns, black peppercorns, pine nuts, roasted or raw sesame seeds, ground turmeric. Some other dried goods can be a little harder to source. Here are some of the more esoteric dried spices and seeds I'll frequently call for in this book. Sichuan peppercorns. For many years, Sichuan peppercorns were banned for import to the United States due to the fear of citrus canker, a bacterial infestation that can harm the foliage of many trees and crops. Although officially banned since 1968, it was only loosely enforced in its later years and completely lifted in 2005. I remember the first time I tasted a dish made with them. It was mid-1999 at New Taste of Sichuan, and the dish was mapo tofu, a dish I grew up loving but didn't truly understand until I tasted the Sichuan peppercorn-laced version. It was revelatory. As I ate the tofu, my mouth was hit with an initial wave of heat, something I expected from the fiery red stew. As I ate more, my lips and tongue slowly started tingling with a unique numbing sensation that tamed some of the spiciness. The alternating feelings of intense heat and total numbness was invigorating and exciting, and I've been addicted ever since. Sichuan peppercorns are the seeds of the prickly ash tree and have a warm, citrusy aroma. They are not spicy at all, but produce the unique numbing, tingling effect on your mouth known as ma in Chinese. They are most commonly combined with hot chilies to produce a flavor combination called mala, numbing hot, associated with Sichuan cuisine. Sichuan peppercorns come in both red and green varieties, with the former being milder and typically used for stir fries or noodles, and the latter being stronger in flavor and used more for soups and braises. The best place to get Sichuan peppercorns I've found is online through sources like the Mala Market, though I've had good luck with pretty much any brand that comes in sealed pouches. If you're going to stock only one type of Sichuan peppercorn, make it red. Bags of Sichuan peppercorns can vary in quality. The useful part of the peppercorn is the outer husk, the red or green bit. Bags with lots of shiny black seeds or twiggy stems are harder to use. You'll have to carefully pick out those seeds and stems before grinding or blooming. The seeds have an unpleasantly crunchy, almost plastic-like texture. Japanese cuisine uses a similar prickly ash berry, but Japanese sansho, a common condiment for grilled eel or noodle soups, is far less numbing than its Chinese counterpart. Sidebar: Sichuan science. What makes Sichuan peppercorns tingle? Unlike other types of pepper, Sichuan peppercorns have no real heat to speak of. Rather, they produce a numbing sensation known as paresthesia. How does this work? Well, Sichuan peppercorns are high in a chemical called hydroxy-alpha-sanshul, which seems to stimulate the Meissner receptors in our lips, mouths, and tongues. Meissner receptors are not taste buds. They are actually nerve endings found all over the body that are responsible for perceiving light touches. A study at the University of London had subjects tasting Sichuan peppercorns, then holding a vibrating rod against their lips, adjusting the frequency of vibrations until it felt the same as Sichuan peppercorns. They found that subjects consistently set the vibrations at around 50 hertz, 50 cycles per second. In other words, tasting a Sichuan peppercorn has the same effect as rapidly vibrating your lips and tongue at a frequency roughly the same as an A-flat 3 octaves below middle C. So, why does that produce a numbing sensation? For the same reason that the sting of a hard slap can reduce the itchiness of a mosquito bite. When powerfully stimulated, or stimulated for a long period of time, our nerves tend to ignore weaker stimulations. Star anise. Star anise is a spice originating from China shaped like an 8-pointed star. It has a licorice-like aroma similar to regular anise, but is only distantly related. It's delicious ground and blended with other warm spices like cinnamon, clove, and nutmeg in Western desserts like apple or pumpkin pie. It's one of the essential spices in Chinese five-spice powder, and also flavors red-braised dishes in which hunks of meat are simmered in a spice mixture of rice wine, sugar, and soy sauce. Outside of the wok, you'll see it used to season fatty Cantonese-style roasted meats like duck or cha siu, the red-tinged roasted pork shoulder you'll find in your steamed buns or sometimes added to soups, vegetables, and other dishes. Whole dried chilies. There are far too many varieties of dried chilies used throughout Asia to ever hope to remember, and you can easily get away with not being too picky if you don't want to be. As a general rule of thumb, when shopping for dried chilies, the smaller they are, the hotter they'll be. If you want to get more in-depth on chilies, listen later for a guide to Sichuan chilies, where to get them, and when to use them. Whole dried chilies should have a pliant texture. If they crack or split when you bend or poke them, they're past their prime and won't offer your food much more than heat and dusty flavor. The best way to keep dried chilies fresh is to keep them in an airtight freezer bag in the freezer. Stored that way, they'll last for years. Alternatively, store them in tightly sealed glass mason jars in a dark, cool pantry for up to around a year. Ground Thai chilies. Ground chilies are an essential ingredient in many Thai dishes. They are powerfully hot and have a flavor that balances bright fruitiness with an almost smoky aroma. They're commonly served as a table condiment for diners to add heat to suit their own taste. In my own house, we keep a small bowl of Thai chili flakes on the dining room table, next to the flaky sea salt and soy sauce, at all times. They're great on pizza, pasta, and soups, too. Some recipes claim that red pepper flakes are a suitable substitute. They are not. Thai chilies are far fruitier and more fragrant. Ground Thai chilies also tend to be very unevenly ground. This is a good thing. You end up with the powdery bits distributed all around the food, with the larger pieces offering little bursts of heat as you eat. Frankly, I can't think of any decent substitute for Thai ground chili. Luckily, it's readily available online, inexpensive, and lasts a long time when stored in an airtight bag in a dark pantry. Raiteep brand chilies are my go-to. Palm sugar. If total authenticity is your goal, you'll need a half dozen different varieties of sugar to make all the dishes in this book. At home, I keep only 4 types: granulated white sugar, brown sugar, Colombian panela, which my Colombian wife would be lost without, and palm sugar. The latter is a staple of Thai, Indonesian, and Malaysian cooking, and comes either as a thick, granular paste in tubs or as 1 to 2 inch hemisphere-shaped nuggets in jars. I prefer the hard nuggets, as the paste tends to get firmer and firmer over time, making it hard to scoop out. A quick trip to the microwave helps if paste is all you can find. Palm sugar is an unrefined raw sugar made by boiling down the sap of various species of palm. Most often, it is cut with some amount of cane sugar to reduce production cost. Its flavor is distinctly nutty, with a caramelized aroma similar to dulce de leche or condensed milk. It's the sweet in the sweet-sour-hot flavor combo so popular in Thai cuisine and an essential ingredient in sweet chili sauce. The good stuff, not the stuff you get with your McNuggets or egg rolls, and numerous northern Thai salads, as well as a counterpoint to the heat of Thai curries. Incidentally, the mortar and pestle is the best way to reduce those discs of palm sugar to a usable, soft, moist crumble. Sesame seeds. Raw sesame seeds are pale white and bland. Toasted sesame seeds, on the other hand, have a complex peanutty aroma tinged with vanilla that pairs well with a host of other flavors, either whole, lightly crushed in a mortar and pestle, or in paste form, which I buy pre-pasted. I'm a fan of convenience when it doesn't sacrifice quality. Who isn't? So I prefer to buy pre-toasted sesame seeds rather than toasting raw seeds myself. Especially because I've easily forgotten about and burnt more sesame seeds than I've successfully toasted. Black sesame seeds have a milder flavor than their white counterpart, but make for a gorgeous garnish on finished dishes. I typically keep both black and toasted white sesame seeds on hand. If you can only find raw sesame seeds, you can toast them by stirring them constantly over medium-low heat in a dry wok until they are golden in color. Immediately transfer them to a rimmed baking sheet and spread them out to cool completely before storing in a sealed container in the pantry. Lily buds. Lily buds, also sold as daylilies, tiger lilies, or golden needles, are the young, unopened blossoms of the daylily. They're about the thickness and length of a vanilla bean with a golden yellow color. When rehydrated and cooked, they have a mild flavor and pleasantly musky floral aroma. They are, after all, flowers, with a slightly crunchy texture. They're widely available at any Chinese grocer, sold dried in plastic pouches. Look for them near the dried mushrooms and plants. Look for lily buds that are pale yellow in texture and still quite pliable. Pass on dry, cracked, or dark buds. Stored in a sealed pouch in a dark pantry, the flowers should last several years. Paired with wood ear mushrooms, lily buds are an essential part of both mushu dishes and hot and sour soup. Wood ear mushrooms. Also known as Jew's ear, a corruption of Judas's ear, wood ear mushrooms are typically sold dried and need to be rehydrated before use. They have very little flavor or aroma, but have a wonderful texture that's simultaneously jellyish and crunchy. They're an essential ingredient in mushu pork and hot and sour soup, but can also be a great addition to simple stir fries. The dried mushrooms can be stored in the pantry virtually indefinitely. Dried shrimp, flounder, and scallops. Dried seafood plays an important role in many coastal and island Asian cuisines. Dried shrimp are a star ingredient of Thai som tam, green papaya salad. Soaked and chopped, they can be added to soups, stir fries, or rice. Dried fish and scallops are rich sources of inosinate and guanosine, two proteins that are found in abundance in seafood, particularly dried seafood, where it gets concentrated. On their own, inosinate and guanosine have no real flavor. They merely act to increase our own perception of savoriness, much like sprinkling your meat with salt will not just make it taste salty, but will actually make it taste more like itself. There's a reason disodium guanolate, a salt form of guanosine, is used regularly as a flavor enhancer in instant noodles and chips. They also enhance the effects of glutamic acid, the amino acid found in things like Parmesan cheese, mushrooms, and ham that give us the saliva-inducing sensation of umami, or savoriness. They're what separate a great wonton soup from the thin, salty stuff you get at the strip mall, or at least the bad strip malls. combined with dried ham, garlic, ginger, chilies, and a handful of other glutamate-rich ingredients, they make XO sauce, an insanely savory condiment created in Hong Kong in the 1980s and so named to capture the cachet of cognac, though it contains none. Dried flounder, scallops, and shrimp are available at Asian grocers or online. In some recipes, they're difficult to replace, but in brothier settings, Japanese kombu, dried sea kelp, will add the umami depth, but not the stronger seafood aromas. Sidebar: why are there so many chilies? Perhaps you've been to a Sichuanese restaurant and ordered dishes packed with fistfuls of crimson-red dried chilies. I know when I was younger, my thought process in these situations went something like this. Am I supposed to eat these? Will I out myself as a noob if I ask? Or will I out myself as a noob if I don't ask and do the wrong thing? They seem kind of papery. I don't like eating paper. Will I like eating these? Oh, crap, here comes the server, and he already saw me poking at them. Better make a decision fast. It is papery. Just look straight ahead and keep chewing. Okay. That skin is finally breaking down, and oh, man, that's hot. Should I ask for water? Will I out myself as a noob if I ask for water? Why didn't I just order the wonton soup, egg rolls, and General Tso's again? At least those dishes won't out me as a noob. Here's the answer. Don't eat those chilies. They are not meant to be eaten. So, what's the point of stir-frying an ingredient that nobody is going to eat? The answer is aroma and visual aesthetics. Typically, those chilies are toasted lightly in the oil before other ingredients are added, lending the finished dish a sweet, fragrant scent. That scent is important. Our tongues and soft palates detect a range of different flavors, but the vast majority of what makes a certain food taste of itself lies in its aroma, the molecules of stuff that jump off the food and into our noses. You can easily test this at home by eating various foods while pinching your nose. Without the help of olfactory sensors, apples and pears taste virtually the same. Heck, even an onion and an apple taste remarkably similar when your nose is pinched. In other words, you don't need to eat those chilies to be able to taste them. The visual appearance of food is also important in our perception. The phrase, "you eat with your eyes," is more than just a folksy saying. Foods that look better taste better. This is because taste is not something that is perceived by our mouths and noses alone. It's something that is created in our brain. A whole confluence of sensory input affects it. Foods that are supposed to be crunchy don't taste as good when they're mushy, even if the flavor is exactly the same. Green ketchup tastes worse than red ketchup. Do you remember when green and blue ketchup were a thing? Very few people recognize that green Haribo gummy bears are actually raspberry flavored. It's true. Take a green gummy bear, close your eyes, and taste it. Those piles of red chilies may not significantly affect the flavor of our food as perceived on the tongue, but they definitely affect the way our brain interprets those flavors. Kombu, giant sea kelp. Kombu, or giant sea kelp, is an essential ingredient in the Japanese stock dashi, and is the natural product from which pure MSG was first derived. It's sold in sheets typically a few inches wide and several inches long, ranging from dark moss green to pale beige or yellow. It comes in a wide range of qualities, at least if you look hard enough. If you have good neighbors, you may even get by with a little kelp from your friends. Most folks will have access to at most a few different quality levels and price points, representing different subspecies of kelp and different levels of retained glutamates. Unless you're after a pristine, subtle, crystal-clear, oceany broth, which, unless you happen to be the chef at a fancy kaiseki restaurant, you probably aren't, there's no need to spring for the fancy stuff. Even the cheapest grade of kombu will make great dashi. I generally recommend looking for kombu that has more of the powdery white mineral deposits dried onto its surface, as my grandmother showed me. This frequently leads me to the cheaper stuff. While subtle broths are favored by many fancy restaurants, my tastes tend to run cheap when it comes to dashi, and those powdery crystallized minerals correlate to more robust umami flavor. I'm not sure whether my grandmother bought it for the flavor or because she was thrifty, but either way, I followed the same path. Chapter 1. The Science of Stir-Fries. Many things can be called fast, versatile, and fun. My old Kodak Pocket Instamatic, Transformers, Bo Jackson. But add delicious to that mix, and suddenly your list gets a whole lot shorter. Stir-frying is fast. Most stir-fry recipes take under half an hour, start to finish, and that's including prep time. The actual cook time of most stir-fries is just a few minutes. Stir-frying is versatile. You can stir-fry meat, you can stir-fry seafood, you can stir-fry Asian vegetables, or Western vegetables, or tofu, or rice, or corn, or mushrooms, or lettuce, or nuts, or noodles, or virtually anything that's at least semi-solid and edible. Stir-frying is fun. I mean, I think it's fun. If you enjoy activities that are simple enough for a first-timer to get good results, but also reward you greatly as you practice and improve your skills, you may think it's fun as well. Stir-frying is delicious. You know it. I know it. Anyone who's eaten at even a mediocre Chinese chain restaurant knows it. Stir-fried vegetables retain their bright, fresh crispness and color. Properly marinated, massaged, and stir-fried meats are tender and packed with flavor. We'll talk more about the importance of massaging meat later. Stir-fried noodles and rice pick up a flavorful char, and when you get really good, some of that elusive wok hei, the smoky aroma you find at good Chinese restaurants. You're going to learn how to get it right at home, no matter what kind of stove you've got. Stir-fries incorporate sauces, condiments, spices, pickles, and aromatics that pack flavor into foods quickly and easily, which means you can build complexity and depth into a dish even on a busy weeknight. Of all the techniques I've learned over the years from all over the world, stir-frying is the one I'd take with me to the desert island. It's how the plurality of meals in my life have been cooked, and I imagine it'll stay that way until I die. The anatomy of a stir-fry. More than anything, stir-frying is about technique. In a November 2018 study led by David Hu, a professor of fluid dynamics at the Georgia Institute of Technology, Hu used computer software to track and model the motion of fried rice in a wok as it was tossed by professional Taiwanese chefs. What they found was that the motion of a stir-fry could be broken down into oscillations that last about a third of a second. Within each of these oscillations, there are four distinct phases, each composed of translation motion, pushing and pulling the wok farther and closer, and rotational seesaw motion, pushing the handle up and down so that the wok pivots where it makes contact with the burner ring, that are slightly out of phase with each other, resulting in a back-and-forth rocking that causes food in the wok to leap toward the chef in a cascade, effectively mixing it. Here's what those phases look like in slow motion. Phase 1. With their hand firmly on the handle or the side of the wok closest to them, the cook pushes the wok forward while it is tilted downward away from them. Phase 2. As the wok gets close to its maximum distance away from the cook will begin to push down on the handle, causing the back edge of the wok to begin tilting back upward. Phase 3. While the back edge of the wok is still rising, the cook will begin pulling the wok back toward them. During this phase, the rotational motion and the rapid translational acceleration cause the food to leap. The food near the top lip of the wok will feel the greatest acceleration, while the food closer to the base of the wok will feel less. This is what causes the cascading waterfall effect. Phase 4. The cook continues to pull the wok toward them, catching the food. Just as the wok reaches its point closest to the cook lifts up the handle, tilting the wok downward again and getting ready to push the wok forward to repeat phase one. So, in effect, each rocking motion...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.